This week, we will discuss device-independent cryptography. In all protocols so far, we said things like Alice prepares BB84 states, or Alice measures in the BB84 bases. But of course, quantum key distribution protocols are not implemented on paper. They're implemented in the real world, in a lab like this one, with mirrors and lasers. So you might be asking, what does the stuff on paper actually have to do with what happens in the lab? In particular, how do I know that what happens in the lab actually corresponds to what I wrote down on paper? Of course, as you might imagine, in the real world, any real devices, and hence any real implementation of a quantum cryptographic protocols, has imperfections. We never quite manage to construct a process in the way as it appears on paper. So it would be great if we were able to prove security, even if we don't quite know whether the desired operations have been implemented correctly. Maybe, in fact, my operations are faulty. They really have errors. Our analysis crucially depended on Alice measuring in BB84 bases. So will the protocol still be secure? Of course, as a theorist like myself, who only works on paper, you might also be wondering, if an experimentalist builds a device for me, how can I trust this experimentalist? Maybe, in fact, the experimentalist is Eve, who is trying to read my keys. It would thus be great if we had a procedure, a test, with which we could show that the key that has been generated is secure, even if we don't trust the devices. You might think that this sounds impossible. How can I prove any security if I don't even know what measurements we have? We saw that security depends on the uncertainty of measurements in the entanglement of the state. So how can I have security if I have no guarantees about that? It turns out that security is still possible even if I don't know what's the state and even if I don't know what are the measurements. And this precisely is device-independent cryptography. To explain this more formally, what we're going to do is we're going to take things to a new level of paranoia. Previously, we had said that Alice and Bob, for example, share a maximally entangled state. Or Alice prepares an EPR pair and she sends the qubit B to Bob. And sure enough, the state that Alice, Bob and Eve would share at the end would of course at least be consistent with some attack that Eve has performed only involving qubit B. But Alice actually did know that she started with a perfect EPR pair. She only has to measure the qubit, one qubit, of the state she prepared. Now we're going to assume that we have no clue what the state is. In fact, the state of Alice might also have huge dimension. Previously, we had also said that if Alice chooses to measure in a standard basis, then this will actually happen. If you think about Alice as a box, which has as input which chooses which measurement to make, and it produces a measurement outcome, then we were guaranteed that for theta equals 0, it would measure in the standard basis, and for theta being 1, in the Hadamard basis. And the same for Bob. Now we're going to take this away. I have no clue what basis is actually going to be measured in. Instead, I will think about Alice's measurement device as a black box. I can tell this box, theta is 0. Please measure in the standard basis. Or I can tell the box, theta is 1. Please measure in the Hadamard basis. But I have no clue what the box really does. The box will produce an answer, XA, but this could come from any measurement. Let me just summarize what this means for quantum key distribution. In device-independent QKD, we will start with a scenario where the state that Alice and Bob share is arbitrary. In particular, this means that Alice may not even have a qubit, but maybe the state rho A is a huge state that has a very large dimension. Also, we will think of Alice and Bob as just measurement boxes that take an input theta, A and theta B for Bob, and produce measurement outcomes xA, xB. But the measurements inside can be arbitrary. Device independence is very powerful. We allow any state and any measurements. Any device, even one which is maybe imperfectly implemented, certainly satisfies these conditions. In device independent, we go one step further and imagine that maybe even Eve is the one who prepared these devices. Eve picked the state and the measurements. It is important to understand that device independence concerns input-output behavior. Alice and Bob give inputs and obtain outputs from their boxes. But there are still things that even device independence does not allow. In particular, it will not be allowed that this device, sneakily, in the middle, communicates back to the eavesdropper. Device independence is very general, but the devices are not completely arbitrary, in the sense that there's no radio inside the device. Note that any device that would have a radio inside could just radio the key to Eve after we completed the protocol, even if the device perfectly implemented the desired measurements and states. It is thus important that Alice and Bob, even though they may not know the devices, have them well shielded. In the literature, you will find all kinds of degrees of device independence. Or let me call it degrees of paranoia. The first question is, how do we use the devices? In most practical scenarios, Alice and Bob will only have one device, and they will use this device sequentially, meaning that they give an input to the device and observe a measurement outcome. Then they obtain the measurement outcome before giving the next input. So it's the same device, and they use it in sequence. It is also possible to consider fully parallel use of the device. But of course, this only makes sense if I actually have many possible devices and I can actually use them in parallel. This means that I give all of the inputs at the same time and only afterwards I get the outcomes. In practice, there's no such thing, typically, as Alice and Bob having millions of devices. So the sequential case is the one which is relevant in practice. You might also ask, do these devices also have memory? Even if I use them sequentially, maybe they remember what happened in the previous round. Indeed, even if we apply the concept of device independence to merely imperfect implementations, that is, Alice and Bob built the devices themselves, but couldn't quite manage to implement them correctly, then this is a very relevant question. Most physical implementations will retain some memory of the previous use, whether desired or not. There are several different models for devices when it comes to memory. The simplest is, of course, assuming that the devices have no memory. They don't remember what happened in the previous round of the protocol, the previous use. Sometimes the devices only have classical memory. And sometimes the devices have full quantum memory of arbitrary size. You might also ask, do these devices communicate with each other in between rounds? In the simples model, there's no communication, or there's only classical communication. In the most paranoid scenario, there's also quantum communication. It is a very appealing model to allow full quantum communication, or in fact communication between different rounds. But of course, whether this makes sense as a practical model depends on whether there's a realistic concern that the devices could communicate without detection, like in the case where they are connected by a direct fiber channel and maybe we don't quite know what's going on in that channel. However, if there's no direct communication line between Alice and Bob, for example because they're far apart in the network, then this model may be overly paranoid. After all, if you were Eve and you could rig the devices to communicate with each other, why not install a radio to send you the key? Device independence is a very general concept that reaches even beyond quantum cryptography. You can think that we all experience nature in a similar way. We are classical. We can only set a classical measurement dial and record outcomes on a piece of paper. Nevertheless, we want to test nature. We want to decipher its ultimate inner workings. It turns out that it's possible to test some aspects, such as gravitational decoherence, in a fully device-independent fashion, even without assuming quantum mechanics. Nevertheless, here we will, of course, focus on quantum cryptography. We will not need to verify the correctness of a complicated experimental apparatus, like the one at QTech that you see here. We will be able to prove security based on very simple tests. So now let's go on to device-independent QKD protocols.